Cape of Storms. By Percival Pollard. Prologue. Life is a cup that is better to sip than to drain. The taste of the dregs is very bitter in the mouth. I shall never forget those words of our dear minister's, I suppose, because so much that has happened since he first uttered them to us as we sat in his Sunday school class has shown me the truth of them. Dick himself, I remember, was especially loath to believe Mr. Fairley's marnation. Indeed, none of us young bloods cared to think that there was anything in the life before us that was not altogether worth living, and when Dick spoke up plainly and quite proudly, arguing against the pastor's words, we were all silent approvers of his challenge. Dick was always the bravest boy in the village, and we had long since come to be admirers rather than rivals. But Mr. Fairley only shook his head and smiled a little. He had a wonderful smile, and his eyes were always shining with kindness, and patted Dick on the head, with a gentle, "Well, well, my boy, let us hope so, let us hope so. Perhaps you will be fortunate above your fellows." The incident dwells in my memory for many reasons. It was, as I have said, a curiously prophetic sentence of our pastor's. Besides that, it was the last Sunday that we were all together in Lincolnville, we boys who had played and fought and learned together. Early in the week, Dick somehow, long after the world has come to know him only as Richard Lancaster, I am still unable to think of him as anything but the Dick of my boyhood, was to leave the village for the world. He was going to begin a life for himself, up there in that mysteriously magnetic maelstrom, the town. Like Dick Whittington of old, and every fresh young blood every day of this world's life, he was going up to town to conquer. Before him lay the beautiful pathway into a glorious future. Promises and pleasures were like hedges to that way that he was going to tread. He was all eagerness, all hope, all ambition. And, to be just, perhaps there was never a boy went up to town from Lincolnville who had better cause to be full of pleasant hopes for his future than Dick. Certainly, it was the first time the little place had evolved such a talent, and it felt a pardonable pride in the boy. It expected, perhaps, even more than he did, and was looking forward to the reflected glory of being his native village. If you have travelled through the West at all, and have anything more than a car window acquaintance with the great Middle West, you know Lincolnville fairly well, I think. Not that you may ever have been to the village itself, but because it is a type of thousands of other villages scattered throughout the country. It is the county seat, and is built upon the checkerboard plan, with a sort of hollow square in the middle, filled, as an Irishman might say, with a park. The sides of this square form the business heart of the place. Each street that runs away from the square is lined with pretty dwelling houses of frame or brick, so that the village looks like an octopus with four large tentacles stretching toward every point of the compass. The streets are fringed with shade trees of every sort, and in midsummer the place looks like a veritable nest of green and cool bowers. The county is strictly an agricultural one. The farmers come to town, as they call it, every Saturday, at least, hitch their horses to the iron railing that surrounds the park, and spend the day selling produce, buying dry goods, implements or other necessaries. The face of the village rarely changes. There is an occasional fire on the square, mayhap, and then the newer building that fills the gap is in decided improvement over the old one. Young men are forever going out into the world, and old men are forever coming back thither to die. For the rest, one might fancy that, if you came into the world again 100 years from now, you would find the same farmers doing their trading at exactly the same stores that they now favor. On occasions of a political convention, or a circus, the town takes on a festive aspect, and the roads leading to the square are filled, all day long, with wagons that have come from the further edges of the county. During the 3 or 4 days of the county fair, too, there is great activity between the village and the fairgrounds, and, if it be a dry summer, the air between those places is merely one huge cloud of dust. Occasionally the pretty little opera house has an entertainment that draws out such of the citizens as have no very severe religious scruples against the theatre. For the rest, the place is an admirable home of quiet. Young blood chafes at this quiet, Old blood finds there the peace it seeks. In the very nature of things, a place of this sort is chiefly concerned with its own affairs. The main theme of conversation are its own people. Everyone is perfectly acquainted with his neighbor's affairs, and not infrequently, in fact, is able to inform that neighbor of certain details relating to the latter, that had until then been unknown to him. So it was that, at the time of Dick's leaving Lincolnville, the good people of that place knew, much better than he did himself, the surety of his engagement to Dorothy Ware. He himself would have been only too glad to be as sure as they were, when he heard the rumors he was given to smiling rather sardonically. He came to me once, I remember, and looked at me for a long time with those clear, gray eyes of his. "Tell me, old man," he said, "do you think she cares for me?" It is a stupid question, this, but almost every boy who is in love puts it to some friend or other, in the quest for confirmation of his fears or hopes. "Why, Dick," I said still more foolishly, "perhaps, now that I look back on it, why, Dick, of course she does. We all do." "Oh," he flung in, impatiently, "I don't mean that." I knew what he meant, but who shall tell, being a man, whether a girl cares or not? Although, if ever a boy was made to be well beloved, surely it was Dick. He was always a high-spirited youngster. Some of his tricks are still legends of the old high school in his native place. He never liked to fight, being naturally mild of temper. But when he was roused beyond endurance, Sly was a veritable Daniel. His father died when he was only 4 years old. To his mother he was the most devoted of sons. It was when he was about 10 years old that his talent for drawing first proved itself. It came to him in the way that it has come to many who have since made the world listen to their names on the old blackboard in the schoolroom. It was a caricature of Mr. Fairley, I remember, who was always very tall and very thin, and whose face was like that of a French general's under the Empire. Dick exaggerated all these peculiarities most deftly with his chalk, and then it so happened that Mr. Fairley himself walked in and found the caricature. He only looked at Dick quietly, and put his hand down on his shoulder with a subdued, "I am a good deal older than you, my boy, a good deal older. You're sorry, aren't you?" And something in our minister's tone must have touched Dick, for the boy put his head down and said, "Yes, sir," with a little choke in his voice. Nor do I think that from that day to this Dick has ever drawn or painted in caricature. But in all other ways he developed his talent day by day with really wonderful results. He always had a rare notion of color. The autumn foliage thereabouts gave him the most startling effects. He used to go out into the woods in midsummer and midwinter. It made little difference to him and come back with some of the prettiest bits of landscape work I have ever seen. There were, it is true, certain palpable crudities in his work, due to the lack of any training save that of his instincts, but those would undoubtedly disappear as soon as he came under the influence of a proper instructor. It was for this that he was going to leave the village and become of the greater world in town. His mother had rebelled at first. She was growing old, and she feared the thought of losing sight of him. But there was no restraining his ambition. To remain cooped up in that little corral of a place all his life, oh, no, that was not at all the thing for Dick Lancaster. The great world, out there, that he had read and heard so much about, that was where he ought to be. And it was there he wanted to wager and to win what was the left in Lincolnville. He could do nothing more there. His life was beginning to be a mere stagnation. He must out and away. This longing for shaking off the shackles of that narrow village life was, as much as ambition, the spur that sent him out into the larger world. And I do not wonder at him. Those small places are not fit arenas for the disporting of ambitions or freedoms. At this time, Dick was a little over 21. He was handsome in a dark, olive-skinned sort of way, and his eyes had the longest lashes I have ever seen in a man. His hair curled a little, though he was forever trying to comb and coax the curl away. He hated it, saying that curls were all right for a girl, perhaps, but not for a man. He was, but for the fact that he was very fond of good cigars, a veritable Pierrot. He had always been very closely under his mother's influence. Even his association with the boys of his own age and class had not been enough to taint him at all. He had a fancy that, now as I consider it, after all these years, seems a most pathetic one, that the world was a very beautiful place in which the wicked were always punished, if not by actual stripes, at least by the disdain of their fellow men. It seems strange, perhaps, that a young man of his age should still hold such notions, but you must remember that in the quieter villages of our country it is possible to hold these fancies all one's life. The town is the great disenchanter. Dick considered that he had two things to live for: his ambition and Dorothy Ware. It was beautiful, the way the boy sometimes rhapsodized, beautiful, and yet in the light of after events, sad. "One day, you know," he said in one of his bursts of enthusiasm, "I will be known all the world over as a great painter. People will come to my studio and wonder at it, and the work in it. They will invite me everywhere. I will be a lion. But I shall always place my work first. Admiration shall go into the last place. And there will be Dorothy. Dear Dorothy. I haven't asked her yet, you know, but I hope, oh, yes, I hope that it will be all right between us. Dorothy will help me in everything. When I begin to flag, or to lose spirit, she will spur me on. She will represent me to the great world of society when I am hard at work. She will be my veritable alter ego. And someday, when I feel that my brush and my hand have in them the passion for my masterpiece, I will paint her face, her face." He took up a photograph that lay on the table before him and looked at it steadily for an instant or two. "Sweet face," he went on, "how shall mere paint ever represent you? There must be love, too. Love and paint. The one is a mere trick of the hand and eye, the other is mine and the mine alone. For no one can love her as I do. As for Miss Dorothy Ware, she was 18 and beautiful. I do not know that any woman really needs a fuller description than that. As for her wit, it is too early in this chronicle to speak of that, nor do I, personally, differ much from Thophile Gautier, when he states that a woman who has wit enough to be beautiful has all she needs. Miss Ware's father had made a great deal of money by the very simple process of growing old. He had been one of the pioneer settlers in that county, and his had been most of the land that the village now stood on. Miss Ware herself, while sensible of her riches, was unspoilt by them. By nature she was of the disposition that one can call nothing else but sweet. She was tender and gracious, she was fond of fun, so long as that fun annoyed no one else. In a word, she was considerate and gentle and lovable. She had been brought up in the South, and she had retained a trace of the Southern accent, so that her speech was in itself a charm. She had natural talents for looking pretty under all circumstances. Some might have said that she had the instincts of a coquette, but I do not believe it of her. She was devoted to children and dumb animals. And whoso has those instincts is intrinsically good. But Miss Ware held that she had by no means had enough of this world's pleasures to begin thinking of so solemn a thing as marriage. Like a large number of the girls of today, she was, first and foremost, out for a good time, as the slang of the time has it. She had certainly the intention of some day marrying the man she loved and making him as happy as she could, but in the meanwhile she wanted to test the world's ability to furnish entertainment quite a little while yet. Which was why, although she was very fond of Dick, she had invariably put him off, when he grew importunate, with a laugh. "Why, Dick," she would say, "don't you know you're absurd to think of such a thing? We're just children yet." "Oh, I know we're of age. But what of that? You don't mean to tell me that you think your life has shaped, or even begun to shape itself yet?" "No. And as for me, I'm going to skirmish around a while yet before I settle down and become old married people. Be sensible, Dick." And Dick, with a sigh in his heart, was, perforce, fain to say that he would try skirmish around. It grated on him, somehow, that phrase. It seemed to hold for him visions of innumerable flirtations, of contact with the world, the flesh and the devil, with the brushing off of the faint, roseate bloom of innocence. It was on the day before Dick's departure for town that Lincolnville received the news of another intended going abroad. The Wares were to sail for Europe before the month was out. Mrs. Ware had long been an invalid. For years the doctors had advised travel, but her husband's objections to any sort of change had hitherto prevailed against her wishes. But now the really dangerous state of Mrs. Ware's health, added to the entreaties of Dorothy, who longed, as do all American girls, for a glimpse of the old country, had brought the old gentleman to acquiescence. He would not go himself, he was getting too old for such a trip. But his wife and daughter should go, if they had set their hearts on it. So that, with the prospective departure of both Richard Lancaster and the girl that rumor had him engaged to, the tongues of the gossips had plenty to do on that day. When Dick first heard the news about the Wares, he was inclined to be downhearted. Then it struck him that it would give him an opportunity for another effort at getting from Dorothy at least the promise of a promise. Then Lincolnville in midsummer, I know few fairer places. There is a cool, green quiet all about that makes for peace and gentleness, and in the whispering of the breeze as it curls through the thick foliage of the spreading trees there is the note of happiness. Happiness, indeed, lies nearer to man in one of these small, serene villages, than anywhere else in the world, save in solitude. But it is rarely that man sees the sleeping beauty that he has sought all his life long. Dick, as he walked along toward the warehouse that splendid afternoon, caught something of the warm, comfortable languor that was in the air, and looked about him with a note of regret in his regard. How pretty it all is, he thought, looking at the familiar houses, with their well-kept lawns and ivy-covered verandas, how pretty! And yet, he sighed, and then smiled with a proud lift of the head, there are other things. He found Miss Ware seated in a hammock on what was known as the front porch. It was a long, low, cool stretch of veranda, reminding one of the style of architecture in vogue in the Old South. It was all harbored in vines that were so luxurious they hardly gave the breeze a fair chance to penetrate. On the other hand, the sun's rays were safely guarded against. Young Lancaster drew up a chair, after she had smiled and reached him one of her hands. He looked at her critically for a moment. Dorothy, he said, I have never seen you looking so pretty. I have never felt so happy, Dick, she said. Because you are going away?
Yes.
And you?
I am happy, too.
And yet, I am rather sorry. I have lived here all my life, this is the first time that I am going away from home. There is something solemn about it, but then the end, oh, the end justifies it all. That is not the chief reason why I'm not altogether satisfied to go away. Dorothy, don't you know the other reason? She opened her eyes a little, and smiled a trifle at the corners of her mouth.
I, Dick, why, how should I know?
Then she saw that he looked hurt and she changed her tone. Dick, she went on, why won't you be sensible about it?
I suppose you mean about me?
Why, Dick, you know I like you, don't you? I've always liked you and admired you, but dear me, can I help it if I feel sure that I don't like anyone yet in that way?
I'd like to, perhaps. But well, I don't.
What can I do?
She looked at him appealingly and reproachfully.
I know, he said, soothingly, I'm an impetuous, thoughtless idiot, I'm afraid, and I hurt you.
And, oh, Dorothy. Don't you know I'd rather suffer torments unspeakable than hurt you?
He put out his hand and touched the one hand of hers that swung beside him, over the edge of the hammock.
But yet, dear, he went on, if I only had a word from you to remember, be it ever so slight, I would fight so much better against the world.
For it is the same today as it was in the Middle Ages, we go to our crusades, all of us, and if we have a sweetheart who will give us her love as an armor, we fight the better fight. Our crusades have a different air, to be sure, but the idea is the same. Don't you know, Dorothy, that if you only gave me some little thing to cling to, I would feel 100 times stronger.
Come, Dorothy. It costs you little to say it. But if I say that word, I must live up to it.
True, your fair conscience would let you do nothing less.
And yet, There are words so slight that they would cost you scarcely anything, while to me they would be coats of mail. For a time there was silence, both looking out over the street where the school children were passing homewards. A buggy rattled by, throwing clouds of dust, then there was quiet again. "If you could say to me, Dorothy, Dick, I won't marry anyone until I see you again, until I come home again. And I'll try to like you that way, why, that would be enough for me." She held up her right hand with a pretty little gesture. "I do solemnly swear," she said. Then she went on more seriously, "Why, yes, Dick, I'll promise that. Small chance of my getting married for a few years, anyway, so I won't have such a very awful time living up to that promise. Now, do you think, sir, that you're engaged to me?"
"No, no, dear, not at all. But you've let me hope, haven't you? That's all I want. You don't know how much happier I'll feel all the time you're away. How long, by the way, do you think you'll be abroad?"
"A year, at the least. I want to see it all, you know, when I do get the chance. Mum'll want to stay in Carlsbad or Ems, or somewhere all the time, but I'm going to get her well real soon, you see if I don't, and then we'll just travel for fun and nothing else. Dick, wouldn't it be great if you could go along?"
"It would, for a fact," he assented, "but it's too good to be true. Besides, I'm going to have some fun of my own."
"Your work, you mean?"
"Yes. Isn't it fun to succeed? And I'm going to succeed. The fighting for success will be fun, and the victory will be fun." His eyes flashed with a fierce battle light. "Today this fire of ambition is the only thing that at all takes the place of the blood fervor that spurred on the knights of the olden times, Dorothy," he said, presently, with a sudden softness in his voice, "will you wish me luck?" She gave him, for answer, her right hand, and looked at him wistfully. She was wondering, perhaps, why it was that she did not love this lovable boy.
"I wish you all the success in the world," she said quietly. And then, as he turned to go, she called after him, in the old formula they had used to each other 1,000 times as boy and girl, "Goodbye, Dick. Be good." The love affairs of a boy and a girl, you may think, are hardly the things that matter very much in the world of today. But the boy and girl of today are the man and the woman of tomorrow, and between these stages there is only the little gulf, so easily crossed, wherein runs the river of knowledge of the world we live in. As soon as we have crossed that, we are become men and women, and are left of our childhood nothing but the wish that it were ours again.